Hi, and thanks for joining us for this special insight. The program you're about to see was recorded in late June with internationally renowned climate scientist Stephen Schneider. A few weeks after we recorded the show, Stephen Schneider, who'd been battling a serious illness, died on a flight from Stockholm to London. He was 65. Whether you agree with Stephen Schneider's views or not, he was a passionate believer that scientists should directly engage with the public on the issue of climate change. It was in that spirit that he agreed to appear on Insight and take on a room full of climate change sceptics. This is the result. And thanks for joining us. Man-made climate change was once a major public concern, but political momentum to address it has waned, and the public has become more sceptical. Tonight, an audience of doubters meet one of the world's leading climatologists who'll try to win them over. Professor Stephen Schneider is from Stanford University and is a lead author with the IPCC. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. Stephen Schneider, thanks very much for joining us here, and thank you to our audience too for joining us here at the University of New South Wales. Good to have you all. Now, I want to give you a flavour, Stephen Schneider, of what you're up against, so I'm going to go to our audience first. Tanya, do you believe in man-made climate change?
Man-made? Not at all.
Why?
No one has proven to me that it's man-made at all. All I see is big hysteria, just for money. The only reason you're getting grant money is because climate change, the planet is warming. It's the only reason you're getting grant money. If we didn't have this hysteria, there would be no grants, there'll be no money, no people money making money at all.
Okay, I'm going to take a few comments and then I'll come to you. Peter Locke, what about you?
No, I don't believe in it at all. I believe in climate change. The climate always changes. But I haven't seen any evidence to date that discounts natural climate change, and I've seen nothing in any of the literature that I've read that indicates that anything is abnormal, A, with the warming or the rate of warming.
Mark, you're nodding your head.
Well, I believe nature has its ways of balancing itself, and if she went into an extreme global warming, I'm sure it's got its own methods of cooling itself.
And Peter, your son, what about you? How old are you, Peter?
I'm 15.
And what do you think?
I'm not too much of a skeptic, but I do believe that climate change is something that happening naturally in our world. But I do think that it can be implemented by mankind, as in that what mankind is doing is just accelerating it. So I don't believe that global warming is man-made. I think that is natural, and that it does fall into our climatical pattern.
All right, Stephen Schneider, plenty for you to deal with there. You've been looking into these issues for 40 years. What's the most compelling argument that you can throw back at these people, and they're all doubters, to make the case for man-made climate change?
Well, I heard the word, I don't believe. Science is not about belief. Science is about evidence. And therefore, your beliefs have to be built upon looking at the whole wide range of evidence. And it is completely legitimate, as everybody said, to look over a long period of history. In fact, looking back at the geologic past, that's the backdrop against which we calibrate our understanding. But you have to be very careful not to make an analogy by saying that what happened in the past is caused by the same things that are happening now. So the point is, what we do in science is we look for underlying cause, not for the fact that before it's been warmer. In fact, it's been quite a bit warmer than now before. 125,000 years ago, it was a degree and a half warmer than now. But we know that the Earth's orbit was twisted more toward the the sun than now, and if we take that and we put it in the same climate models we use to study global warming, it predicts it was about that much warmer. So what we try to do is look at the wide range of evidence, and that we don't use analogies. What we do is we use the understanding built on how the system works, and I'll be happy to explain that more.
Janet, you wanted to say something.
Well, I think it's very good that Professor Schneider has started out by saying we need to look at the evidence, and I don't think anybody in this room disagrees with that. The hypothesis that we are currently faced with is that carbon dioxide is the driver of climate change, and throughout history we have proven evidence that temperature has been much colder with higher degrees of CO2 in the atmosphere than what we have today, and vice versa.
Can I just ask you, Janet, do you believe that the Earth is actually heating up at the moment? Do you believe in that the warming is occurring regardless of the cause?
Well, I don't believe anything. I look at the evidence, and the evidence says that we did have warming. Yes, we have been in a long-term warming trend. The last 15 years, we have had no statistical warming. And so I think that's a problem with this hypothesis. I believe that the hypothesis has been shown to be false.
Yeah, okay, that's wrong, sorry. That's not what the evidence says. First of all, there's plenty of statistical warming over the last 15 years. The argument is whether it was, quote, statistically significant, which is a particular kind of statistical test that's very stringent. In fact, first half of 2010 is the warmest year ever recorded in the thermometer records. And that what happened is from 1992 to about 2002, it went up so fast you could have said we were going to hell in a handbasket. Then from about 98 on to about 2009, it was relatively flat. This is what climatologists call noise. That means that the decade-to-decade fluctuation in the climate is about the same size to slightly larger, than the long-term multi-decadal trend that you would expect from human activities. So to point to any one decade, like the decade of the 2000s, and say, well, that hasn't changed very much, therefore this disproves global warming, would be as ridiculous as the deep environmental groups, and some of them did it, pointing to the decade from the 1990 to 2000 and say, oh my God, it was terrible. The thing about global warming is that it's global and long-term. No climatologist defines climate change on the basis of a decade. It's usually defined on the basis of multiple decades. And on that multiple decades since about 1850, what IPCC said is correct. It's unequivocally warming. But that's not a very, very strong statement, because how much of that's due to Ma Earth and how much of that is due to us?
Okay.
That's a tougher question, which I will be happy, in fact, must address, because many of you brought that up
opening comments. We'll get on to that in a moment. Does that answer your question, Janet?
Well, I've heard that explanation before. I think we've got a fundamental problem in that we're wanting to change our entire economic structure based on the hypothesis that CO2 is the driver of climate.
Yeah, that's a different question. What we call detection attribution. I promise you I'll talk about that. Right now we're only talking about, is the climate changing? I would argue the answer to that is it's unequivocal that it's changing. That is not the same thing as saying why.
Okay.
That's a much more sophisticated and tough problem.
Okay, Chris, I know that you have a question about climate records. You're worried about the records.
Yeah, and it kind of goes to what was being said just a moment ago about extrapolating over too short a period. And with respect, 160 years in geological time is a hell of a short period to extrapolate anything over. What concerns me is this focus on what you call the thermometer record, I think was the term you used. There are historical records, albeit not written down in nice scientific tables, which run a much longer period and show big changes in the climate. Once upon a time, you could go grow wine grapes in England. Then suddenly you couldn't. And then about 20 years ago, you could again. So when you talk about the climate changing over this short period, what worries me, and with respect, I don't know what you have to say, but many of the people who do talk about climate change ignore all of these other records, everything before 1850.
Okay, I'll get a response from you to that in a moment, but this is kind of tied in as well. I want to just show what geologist Ian Plimer has to say about warming, and warming not being all that bad, according to him.
That's two issues. We'll take both of them.
In Roman times, we had 600 years of warm climate. Sea level didn't rise, but it was warm. And we know that because they kept good records about agriculture. And it was warmer, probably 5 degrees warmer than now. Then it suddenly got cool. Now, those prosperous Roman times were wonderful. When it got cool, we had famine. We had a breakdown of the social structure. We had depopulation, and the weakened population got hit by the plague. That's what global cooling did. Then it warmed again. The first to feel it were the Vikings, and they grew barley, wheat, and had cattle and sheep on Greenland. Why do you think it was called Greenland? Eric the Red was saying, come to Greenland, wonderful benign climate. He was running a great immigration program. It was warm.
Okay, Stephen, response to that first.
First of all, Eric the Red was a land swindler. Iceland, which is called Iceland, was much warmer than Greenland, and it was a way to get people to go there. Yes, it was a little bit warmer in Greenland, but you cannot judge global climate on the basis of what happens in Rome or on the basis of what happens in Greenland. You have to take a look at the entire globe. And one of the things that was clear is that the North Atlantic sector, right, Europe and Greenland, those areas, they have a much larger excursion of temperature in the short run than does the whole hemisphere. And that's now been studied quite carefully by looking at tree rings, which give you the widths of the rings, tell you something about what's going on. They're not a perfect measure. That's not the only thing you do. You look at pollen. There are groups which have spent a lot of time. People have made assertions that the climate scientists are not looking over the last 5,000 to 10,000 years. I'm sorry to say that's not true. Please read the Intergovernmental Panel on climate change report, and there's an entire chapter of what we call paleoclimate, and it in fact takes a look over that record. And if you take a look at the reconstruction of the last 1,000 years, and it's controversial how to do it, because a tree ring is not measuring, it's not a thermometer, but it's proportional to temperature. So what you have to do is calibrate it, meaning taking a look at the width of those rings while they overlap with the actual thermometers, which are much more accurate measures. Once you do that calibration, now you run it back 1,000 or 2,000 years. And when you do that, you find that the last 40 to 50 years are warmer than any calibration anyone has done on the hemisphere, on a hemispheric basis, not Greenland, not Northern England, not what we call cherry-picked locations, which could be warmer or cooler, but the whole hemisphere. And that's how the scientific community does it.
Okay, Ian, you've got a question about whether the temperature is rising because of global warming.
I understand that carbon dioxide that man produces is 3% of what nature produces. How can small changes to our production of CO2 impact upon something as large as the Earth? It seems absurd.
Yeah, no, it's not only not absurd, it's absolutely true, but it's a very good question. Because what happens is that nature has long been taking carbon dioxide from the air, putting it into green plants. And then, of course, this is what happens in the springtime when the sun comes out stronger and photosynthesis goes faster than respiration. That's right, that's decay when the CO2 goes out. Then in the wintertime, when the sun goes away, goes to the other hemisphere, gets cold and the leaves fall and then they decompose. So there's a large natural seasonal cycle, which in any one year is larger than human injection. But that cycle is balanced, meaning that the amount of CO2 that comes out of the air into the trees or into the oceans, though much larger in any one year than what humans inject, almost exactly the same amount comes back up. So what we are is we're a net on top of that. So it's like saying that, you know, in your family budget, you have large income and you have large expenses. But if now all of a sudden, and let's say it's $100 and $100, now all of a sudden, if you add $3 of income, it's still going to accumulate in your savings, even though the income was $100 and the expense was $100. So what happens is...
Sorry to butt in on this. Look, you're not answering the question. I said that we produce approximately 3% of natural production. You haven't really addressed that. You've given some prevaricative answer. I mean,
perhaps you haven't understood the answer. What I said is the amount of carbon dioxide coming from the atmosphere
you
goes in and out, and it's larger than the what we inject. But it's in balance.
If we produce 3% carbon dioxide of the total production of carbon dioxide, it's still a small percentage. If we reduce our carbon dioxide by 50% and send ourselves back to the Stone Age, we've made very little difference. Could you answer that question? I did understand what you said perfectly.
Well, then I don't understand how you could reach that conclusion. Are you trying to say